undermines it effectively. Yeah. Yes.
First thing I'd like you to look at is the little incised stone up here. It says built in 1670, rebuilt 1815. That causes we need a little bit of interpretation on that. In 1670, it wasn't legal to build meeting houses. However, we have a deed of 1683, which I've seen in a friend's house, and that tells us that in 1679, one Robert Ford purchased an acre of land called Spiceland, and to build a good and commodious dwelling house. And this is how the early Quakers got round this way finding a place to go and worship. And they installed two caretakers, who were not Quakers, and they had the responsibility of looking after the place and providing hospitality for friends who were moving around, obviously, in those days, and this place being remote even then, it was important. So as we passed the entrance here, we saw on the left hand side the old stables, which are the local name is the Linney.
The what?
The Linney, L-I-N-H-A-Y. It's a Devon name, which is an open sided stable.
Yeah.
So we don't quite know what the original building looked like. It was probably cob and thatch and quite a simple building. But it was called good and commodious, and with so that the friends could meet there in peace and quiet in the country. And it was rebuilt in this style in 1815, in stone, in the fashion of the times. Very simple, with simple fittings inside. We'll have a look at that later. So the door's original, we got that painted and just done up a bit. The windows have been replaced once or twice. And on the end here we have the little caretaker's accommodation, which we've now extended into this part, which is the old woman's meeting room, so-called. So looking this way, we're looking south, and Exeter is in that sort of direction. And this ridge here, which you see that kind of flat whaleback, is where the famous Spiceland Training Centre was during the war. Now, there's often some kind of confusion in people's mind when they hear the name Spiceland Training Centre. I think it was here. But it was in a house, in a large house, which is hidden by the trees there. And there's a book which, if you haven't seen it, I would recommend that you try to find. It's called Cops Without Sources by Stanley Smith. And it's the history of the Quaker Training Centre, which was purchased by Devon and Cornwall Quarterly Meeting in 1939. It's a house which was about 100 years old at that time. And it was set up to train conscientious objectors, not just Quakers, other denominations, and it lasted from 1940 to 1943, and it was something like 400 people passed through there, and that's part of our story as well, because in that time, in 1940, the meeting house here was deserted, and it had been essentially closed since the 1880s. Although our Exeter friends always point out that they looked after the place and they arranged what they called public meetings. In the summertime, they would come out in a jolly from Exeter, and they would have somebody with a long beard who, you know, gave a long dissertation from the elders' bench. I don't know how often it happened, but some of the locals here, you know, there's still a tradition around this, and they just couldn't believe it was happening, really. But it kept going, and there was a caretaker here living there. And we have something like 3.5 acres here. And we'll just walk down here and explain a little bit about the land that we have. And they were employed as a caretaker. And they paid a small rent, 6 and 8 pence it was in 1935. And they obviously did a bit of agriculture around here. But because of the... This cat, yeah, do you notice anything about it? It's got six toes.
Yes.
Oh, yes.
A very curious cat.
Oh, that's strange, yeah.
We got a cat once and we got it home, found it hadn't got a tail. Sorry.
So, the archaeological interest. This is what is called a pediment. So this is, you know, part of the old site built up. And if we just go down a few inches, we're on to cobblestone cobbles. So when they built the stone meeting house in 1815, they probably demolished the old thing, or what they've fallen down.
There's a tiger.
And this is how we see it, as we repaired it in 2 years ago. It was in time for our 200th centenary in 2015. So it's in quite good sort of state of repair, I hope now. We spent quite a lot of money on it. Obtained various grants from people. So if we just, again, I'll just sort of explain where we are. Exit in that direction, Taunton in that direction. As I explained in my little, very light sort of history here, it was on an ancient road which ran between Taunton, the county town of Somerset, and Exeter, the county town of Devon. And we're a very short distance from the Somerset border here. The earliest Quaker meeting in these parts was in the town of Clumpton. You may have passed that on the M5. And that was that's a bigger town. It's now a town of about 8,000 or 9,000 people. And that was an important woolen industry place. And that's really, in the 1650s, it's one of the earliest Quaker meetings in the country. And George Fox did go there, 1654, 1655. And in Meetings for Sufferings, there are records of persecution of the Quakers in Clumpton in late parliamentary times, 1656, 57, 58. And so things were getting a bit difficult for them in Clumpton. But when the king was restored in 1660, things took a real turn for the worst. And, you know, you've probably heard of the Act of Uniformity, 1662. There were a series of acts which were to establish in better terms the Church of England, and to try to get these unruly non-conformists under control, of which the Quakers were regarded as pretty well the worst. And there are references in newspapers, and they associated Quakers with the Fifth Monarchists, who, you know, had an armed rising in 1660. So the upshot of that was that the Quakers were really driven out of Clumpton, and they wanted a place, you know, to meet, peace and quiet. And one of the things of the Acts of Uniformity in 1662 was the 5 Mile Act. People may have heard of that, which stipulated that a non-conforming minister couldn't live within 5 miles of a post town. So Spiceland was 5 miles from Clompton, a post town, and 5 miles from Wellington, which is on the way to Taunton, the next post town. So there's a reference in George Fox's diary of 1662 that he held a blessed meeting 5 miles from the town of Clompton. And we know he was going to Wellington, so it's pretty well certain he was in Spiceland. And by tradition, he was came here two other times in the 1660s, and he is reputed to have held meetings in what is called the Orchard, which is this bit we look down past the hedge there, which is our new burial ground. I have a reference in the Devon Record Office that he came here in 1669, but I always look for contemporary references. You know, I don't. If people, there's tradition, there's something behind the tradition. Part of the tradition says he preached to 1,000 people, and that regard is just impossible in the 1660s. How could 1,000 people get together in a place like this, with all the restrictions on the roads and soldiers around the place? If you look at his journal, he says he had a maximum of he thought he had almost 200 people at one meeting. But there is a reference I've come across, a contemporary reference in 1691, which was a man called John Banks, who was a travelling minister, who came here, and I've got his diary, and it says there were near 1,000 people at Spiceland, 1691. But of course that was after the Act of Toleration in 1689. So essentially the reason why Spiceland is here is because there was an established meeting earlier, and people wanted somewhere to meet in peace and quiet near the county border. So the magistrates of Devon would leave it to the magistrates of Somerset to sort these Mr. Quakers out, and the lot in Somerset would say, "Oh, it's actually in Devon, so it's not on." And the Quakers were very good at legal things. I mean, they followed the letter of the law. And they said, you know, if they were apprehended at an illegal meeting of worship, that the law said they had to be transported to be arraigned before a magistrate. Now, that cost the authorities money. They'll have to get a horse and cart, nothing. And of course, they wouldn't sort of go. They would just probably sit there quietly and wait to be caught. So, I don't think there was any. They were fairly safe for that. I mean, there were, of course, you know, problems in the towns and so on. But that is the reason why Spiceland started off. And if I, maybe later on I'll talk a bit more about the subsequent history of Spiceland. So we just have a little walk around here. One of the things, of course, was important to the early days, and the nonconformists, you know, as well as Quaker, have a place to bury their dead away from. So you'll see how this corner has fallen away here, and if you look at that window, it's slightly distorted.
The whole corner came away.
Well, it opened up, and we put in steel ties. It's quite well disguised across the gap, and then used line work in the gap. It's quite well done. So we're now in the old burial ground, which was closed in 2008. And in this small area of a quarter of an acre, we've got something like 600 burials of Quakers. And from the earliest days of the 1680s, the earliest one that we've got a record of is 1681. This was one George Russell, who was a wool comber. And he died in prison in Exeter at the age of 81 in 1681. He's buried somewhere here, but you'll notice that the You know, we've only got something like 17 or 18 of the earlier headstones. And this is one set of the family of fries. Not the chocolate fries. They were another manufacturing family. These are dated from about 1780 to about 1820. Quite a quality in death as in life. And people that had fancy grave markers were advertising their wealth,
okay, and
their importance. So it was actually, strictly speaking, wasn't allowed until sometime in the 1860s, wasn't it? There was a tendency on the slightly more well-off Quakers to bend the rules a bit. And this is the famous, this is another set here, which is quite interesting. These are footstones as well as headstones, you see. So this grave here, I've got a footstone and a headstone.
That's quite unusual though, isn't it, for Quaker burial grounds, isn't it, to have a footstone and a headstone?
And this is another family called the Weirs, which were relations of the Foxes, the woolen people, not George Fox, but and they were, the previous Weirs were quite established Puritans, and they were on the side of Oliver Cromwell in the Civil Wars.
So that's the family at the talk today, the Weirs and the Foxes, then, isn't it? Yeah, absolutely.
There was one of our Binns family that was in Exeter area, and eventually there was a Frances Binns, the daughter, and she married a Nicholas Weir, and their, either their son or their grandson, I forget which, was called Jonathan Binns Weir, and he emigrated to Australia, and he wrote a book about his journey over there, and he also helped people to emigrate to Australia in a big way. I think he made it, almost made it his business.
Well, I think this is part of the story, really, of Spiceland, and you know, the Quaker community, which existed in, you know, in the late 1600s. 1700s was the period. I mean, I've done a study of the burials, and in the decade 1700, 1710, we had 62 burials here. That's the ones I can trace, possibly more than that.
Okay.
I don't think that the infants are always recorded.
Yeah.
And that would, I mean, making assumptions about lifespan and early mortality and so on, I reckon that probably meant we had something like 200 people worshipping at Spiceland in those days. And so you might ask where they came from, but there were 10 rural parishes. I mean, there's no big community around here. I mean, Honiton's probably the nearest to. There's one or two from, spelled with all kinds of different ways, Honeytown.
I've always said Honiton.
So well, the historically minded people say Honiton, and they reckon it's after a Saxon patriarch called Honey, H-U-N-I, Honey. Honey's town.
Well, that is what Doomsday Book says.
Is it? All right, yes. That's
So what would you say?
Well, I grew up knowing that the place is called Honiton.
Okay.
But since I came to live in Honiton, I've changed my pronunciation because nobody
says
that.
Well, I learned that, of course, from Robin Staines. Right. Do you remember Robin? Do you?
No.
Oh, he's famous. Mm-hmm. He was very keen on that particular aspect of things. Anyway, So I'll have to. You may see some
what
of
the purpose of the foot.
It's well. There's one of the old ballads. Lay a stone. Lay something by my head and feet, isn't it?
But I've not seen foot. Have you seen footstones in any Quaker burial ground? It seems really strange.
I've seen them with some of my ancestors that weren't Quakers.
Mm-hmm. That weren't, yeah, absolutely. But to have them with in a Quaker burial ground seems. I'd love to know what people thought at the time if that was seen as. Mm-hmm. What date are those ones? What date are the footstones?
Those are 1780 to around 1800.
So it's interesting. So, but down here, there's a sole one down there.
There's
one
down there. Why? That one is actually the latest one, 1841. And that is a lady from Uffculme. But all here, you see, there's hundreds of people here now. And you see the odd mound here as well. And originally, well, how it worked. I've got a plan which I've dated to about 1760. And from that there on, the position of the burials are marked.
But from which date, sorry? From
1760-ish.
Okay.
It doesn't actually have a date on the plan, but I can do that by inference. And knowing the names. But previous to that, there was hundreds of people buried here without any markers. And they're probably just buried in a piece of cloth, piece of wool, shroud. And I'm sure that because the 1760 plan covers the whole area, that they were imposed on the earlier burials. And also, if you look around here, I don't know if you can see, but there's the odd kind of rick appears. Now, what they did, at least with some of them, is they had brick-lined burials on top of the old burials, and they put a mound on top. And this is our, what we call our children's room here. This is where we have, it's quite old, that. They repaired it a bit recently. But that was the second hand when we got it in about 1980. And I've got a story that when they were putting the foundations in, they were just skeletons exposed. Of course, 1980, quickly covered it all.
That's interesting. Yeah, because I don't know what it's... With Church of England burials, isn't it? It didn't matter if your body was kind of a bit disinterred as long as you stayed in the site.
In the consecrated ground.
Yeah, so I assume for Quaker burials, if they were still here, it wouldn't have mattered so much, would it? Would it have mattered?
The soil is also slightly acidic here, so the bones do decay fairly rapidly.
It's fascinating, isn't it?
So if we just, if I've got time, we can just go a little bit further down.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is the oldest stone?
What time constraints do we have?
I haven't got a restriction.
No.
Well, if you could do tell me to.
Yeah, yeah, no, it's fascinating. It's fascinating.
So,
I guess we've got to get back before it goes dark. Otherwise we might not find our way out.
Well, when you came in and the car park.
Yeah.
It was over there, and you saw a road, a new gate, and it said Spice and Burial.
Yeah.
So this goes round here and down just on the other side of that bank there. And we can see back up. That was something I opened up, well I say I opened up because I'm an engineer and I know about things, a few years ago to get access to our new burial ground, which was the old orchard. George Fox's opportunity to have preached all those years ago. So that's quite an interesting, nice walk, which avoids the tenants, who want the privacy during the week and so on. We can look back up there. So let's just move down here.
Which is the oldest stone you can see?
The old ones in that line there, 1780 is about. But that's one family of the Friars of Woodgate, and just in a row there. Yes. then the weirs here, there's five weirs, three with the footstones, and they're about same sort of period, 1780 to about 1800. This one is Catherine Stark of Uffculme, I've established that. and this is the tenant garden here, which a lot of places lying to woods here, looking after a garden of vegetables and flowers.
I think one of the first of our meetings I ever went to, I think it was, and I was quite found it quite interesting that they'd use the burial ground for growing trees to make money with. I thought, I wish more people did that these days.
Well. Once you get into burial grounds, green burials, trees, planting, you're on very, how can I say, emotional ground. I just keep out of that altogether.
I think they used it for growing trees before they'd actually got the bodies in there to make money out of the land.
What people don't realise is trees grow.
Yeah.
And they may look nice, but that tree there, for instance.
Yeah.
The tenants put that in about 40 years ago. It was a Christmas tree they had, they just stuck it in the ground and it's got there. And the roots have got over the drainage pipe. Yeah. And, yes. So, I have a battle with people about trees, I'm afraid. I'm a meadow man.
Yeah.
One of my...
You go to places like, where is it, went to, where that school is.
Where both?
It's where the one Quaker school is.
Sidcot or?
I forget now. But anyway, the burial ground that they've got there, they've got bees and that in them. And then they got opened it up to allotments as well.
Oh, right.
And yeah, I like that.
Oh well, that's an idea. Well, there's a lot I could get onto, but I won't at the moment. So this area here, this is an in-between area which we hold when we've got a big sort of gathering or do. We put a marquee up here, we have camping and stuff like that here, and musical things. We're going to have if you look on the website, you'll see that. We're having a garden party in July, so we're having music and stuff like that here. And so we put up marquee here and like that. So this is an in-between space. And on this side is the new burial ground, which is traditionally the orchard. The orchard trees have disappeared, apart from one or two. Been planted around the edge recently, and the idea is to convert this into a flower meadow. And so at this end we see the more modern burials. This is where we have the ones with headstones. At the bottom end we have green area which is without any grave markers, and that's where I'll end up if the slow had me. So this is about 3/4 acre, so this will keep us going a while, I think.
How does it work with plots? So if someone's buried here, could you then ask for the place next door to be kept for you, or would that not be seen as acceptable?
It does happen, yes. I mean, for instance, this lady here, Carrie Baker, who died quite recently, 2016, her partner is in the same plot.
Okay, so yeah. So.
So that's one on top of the other, I think.
Okay.
We haven't come across that one, but I'm sure that
would be arranged. Okay. Yeah.
We've got plenty of room here. So what also one of the just
no.
Your,
surgeon.
If you had time, you could walk down there and look at the bottom end. But it's, there's other things to show you. So we planted this hedge about 5 years ago, and
it's doing nicely.
Yeah, it's coming on nicely, isn't it? To create a separation between this area and the new burial ground. So this is our pathway. If you remember, when you came in, you saw a sign which said burial ground. So we can get vehicles down here. This area is there's sort of plastic stuff underneath and grass is growing up. But when I investigated it about 4 or 5 years ago, it was just covered in mud and sponge and all kinds of stuff. So we took out about 2 or 3 feet of here and put in some hard core and opened up the old road. It's called the Drove Road. Now, that again, it tells you something. I mentioned the road between Taunton and Exeter. The droving period was, generally when the town's Industrial Revolution, mid-17 converts, and so at that time the farmers would take advantage of the growing population of the towns, would drive their animals and to the towns. But of course, there was a limit to how far they could get in a day. So when we've got a drove road here, I've got no concrete evidence of it, but in the plan you can see a circular enclosure down there. And I'm pretty certain that this is what happened. It was a laying up place for the animals at night. And it was usually by a river, and often called these places colt harbours. And so they would take the animals down here, put them in an enclosure, which was walled, and then they would start off again in the morning and set off for Exeter.
It's the sound of the birds, isn't it? It's just you can't hear anything else other than the sound of the birds, really, can you?
Well, it's an ID term. There's a blackbird singing up there. There's a blackcap up there. And the swallows lying around.
I'm doing a very good job. I'm being bitten to bits.
Are the grey stuck by hand, or do you get a mechanic, or how does it?
Well, I designed it so you could get a vehicle down here.
If you wanted to.
Yeah. We've got this ancient guy living in Kentishbier who's always dug them by hand.
Okay.
And he's very neat and very tidy. And, but whether, we can, when he goes.
We'll see. We have to rethink it. But how extraordinary.
We can't get vehicles down here.
Like they used to do, they used to make a little chitty, didn't they, to the grave maker to make a grave, and that's what we see in our birth, marriage, and burial. But the old ones, do they still do? What do they do these days?
I keep out of that. Quakers are very peaceful people.
Well, that was their legal authority to bury it, wasn't it? Burying bodies.